Good morning. Thank you for joining us for morning prayer and worship. I'm so thankful that you could take this time out to spend with us and to spend with your Lord as we go through our prayers and songs, and we remember that no matter what happened this week, no matter what kind of circumstances you find yourself, right now, you're here in the presence of God. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength, my Redeemer. Psalm 19:14. Let us sing together the great hymn, Guide Me Thou, O Great Jehovah. Isn't that a beautiful hymn? Thank you again for joining us today. Now let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your name, amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Lord, open our lips, and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Come, let us adore him. And now the Jubilate, Psalm 100. Be joyful in the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song. Know this, the Lord himself is God. He himself has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and call upon his name. For the Lord is good, and his mercy is everlasting, and his faithfulness endures from age to age. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen and amen. And now the appointed psalm and our readings for today.
Psalm 124. If the Lord had not been on our side, let Israel now say, if the Lord had not been on our side when enemies rose up against us, they would have swallowed us up alive in their fierce anger towards us. Then would the waters have overwhelmed us and the torrent gone over us. Then would the raging waters have gone right over us. Blessed be the Lord. He has not given us over to be a prey for their teeth. We have escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowler. Our snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Reading from the book of Exodus. Now a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. He said to his people, look, the Israelite people are more numerous and more powerful than we. Come, let us deal shrewdly with them, or they will increase, and in the event of war, join our enemies and fight against us and escape from the land. Therefore, they set taskmasters over them to oppress them with forced labor. They built cities, Pithom, Ramesses, for Pharaoh. But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread, so that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians became ruthless in imposing tasks on the Israelites and make their lives bitter, with hard service and brick and mortar and brick, and in every kind of field labor. They were ruthless in all the tasks that they imposed on them. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, one of them was named Shifra and the other Pua, when you act as midwives to the Hebrew women and see them on birthstool, if it is a boy, kill him. If it is a girl, she shall live. But the midwives feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, and they let the boys live. So the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and said to them, why have you done this and allowed the boys to live? The midwives said to Pharaoh, because the Hebrew women are not like Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them. So God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. Then Pharaoh commanded all his people, every boy that is born to the Hebrews you shall throw into the Nile, but you shall let every girl live. Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine baby, she hid him 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got a papyrus basket for them, plastered it with bitumen and pitch. She put the child in it and placed it along the reeds at the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen. The daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe in the river while her attendants walked beside the river. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was crying and she took pity on him. This must be one of the Hebrews' children, she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew woman to nurse the child for you? Pharaoh's daughter said to her, yes. So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages. So the woman took the child and nursed it. When the child grew up, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and she took him as her son. She named him Moses because she said, I drew him out of the water. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Canticle 17, Song of Simeon. Lord, you have set your servant free to go in peace as you have promised. For these eyes of mine have seen the Savior, whom you have prepared for all the world to see, a light to enlighten the nations and the glory of your people, Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Reading from the book of Romans. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body, we have many members, for not all the members have the same function. So we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering the teacher, in teaching the exhorter, the exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Canticle 13, song of praise, song of the three young men. Glory to you, Lord God, for your fathers. You are glory of praise. Glory to you. Glory to you for the radiance of your holy name. We will praise you and highly exalt you forever. Glory to you in the splendor of your temple, on the throne of your majesty. Glory to you. Glory to you seated between the cherubim. We will praise you and highly exalt you forever. Glory to you beholding the depths and the high vault of heaven. Glory to you. Glory to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We will praise you and exalt you forever. Amen.
And now the gospel reading. When Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked the disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, still others Jeremiah, one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You're the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. And the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. The gospel of Christ. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for remembering us. We thank you for remembering us even when we do not think of ourselves, and caring for us and never letting us go. We pray that we will remember those who are suffering today, those who do not have hope, that we can bring them hope just as you brought us hope through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. When I was in high school, and this was in 1980, I'm dating myself here, I decided to start going to a Christian fellowship. This was strange because I was a Jehovah's Witness at the time. And my best friend, Jose Ortiz, who was a Pentecostal, invited me, and when I told him my reservations, he said, "Don't worry about it. I will stick up for you." And he did. In fact, there was a time when the group tried to vote me out because I was suffering from depression. I wasn't a very pleasant person to be around. And I remember Jose telling me about this incident later, not at that moment. And he said, "I told the group, if we can't stick up for Omar, if we cannot reach Omar, then why do we exist as a group? What good is being a Christian if we can't love those who we don't love that much?" and him sticking up for me is why I am here today. Him remembering our friendship, remembering the love we have for each other, is why I am here today. And today in our text in Exodus, we're going to look at another example of how remembering God's word and God's character can end up saving many lives. Now remember, in this particular text, it opens by narrating the descent of Jacob's line into enslavement. The Pharaoh pursued a ruthless policy of discrimination, enslavement, and extermination. But what is most striking about the first chapter of Exodus is not the brutality of Pharaoh, but the humanity of the two heroines, the midwives, Shiphrah and Puah. The Pharaoh commanded these two midwives to kill the male Israelite children. And in the first, at least to our knowledge, the first biblically recorded act of civil disobedience, Shiphrah and Puah responded by affirming God's image. The midwives, fearing God, did not do as the king of Egypt told him. They let the boys live, Exodus 1:17. Now, what are we to make of this biblical story of the midwives, especially in contrast with the behavior and wishes of Pharaoh? Well, I want to point out a couple of things about this. First, this is a story of how when you actually remember God's words and do them, they can have a profound effect on your society. Remember what I said, remembering and doing. Now, again, while the king of Egypt had no regard at all for the lives of the Israelites, in fact, they were frightened by them, the midwives here, the least most powerful people in this narrative, are actually the ones that emulate God the most. They are the ones that stand up for God. They are the ones that remember God's mercy. Now, this episode reminds me of a teaching in Deuteronomy. Whenever a king became king of Israel, he had to keep a copy of the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. He had to write out his own copy and have it beside him at all times. This would be the equivalent of every president of the United States having to write out the Declaration of Independence or the Bill of Rights or the Constitution. Now, I want you to think of how tedious it is to write out all five books of the Torah, how tedious that would be. And I'm going to read the passage in Deuteronomy that commands this. When he is seated on his royal throne, he shall have a copy of this teaching, the Torah, written for him on a scroll by the Levitical priest. Let it remain with him and let him read it in all his life so that he may learn to revere the Lord, his God, to observe faithfully every word of his teaching as well as the laws. Did you catch that? He has to write it out. He has to have a copy that was written by the Levites, and then he had to actually write it out himself. Now, why was that? It was because it was to remind him that he was no better than the lowliest person in his kingdom. That all the laws in that book, they apply to him. That king or queen, let me not forget there were also queens in Israel, they had to write out the Torah and then they had to keep it by them at all times. Now I want you to think about how that impressed. Now, some of the kings were still bad kings, just like some of us, even though we read the Bible constantly, don't live up to it. But it set a bar for all the king, the rulers of Israel, kings or queens. It said, this isn't something you just read. This is something you inwardly digest. This is something that should become part of your life. And because it became part of the lives of the midwives, they actually lived up to God's commandments. You know, what's really remarkable in this text in Exodus is the lowly women who are recorded are going against the most powerful person in the world. And it's interesting how they don't mention the name of the Pharaoh, but they mention the names of these women. In this way, the biblical narrator expresses his scale of value. All the power of the mighty Pharaoh, the outward magnificence of his realm, the dazzling splendor of his court, his colossal monuments are all illusions. And that the ultimate power lies with these women. These women who are disregarded, but they decide, they remember God's word, and then they do God's word. Remember our reading in Romans 12. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, present your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not conform to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good, acceptable, and perfect. The Exodus account of God's liberation of the Hebrew people from their slavery in Egypt just begins with Pharaoh deciding he wanted to kill all the Egyptians. But then it moves on to the women of the story, not only the midwives, but the Egyptian princess who ends up picking up Moses. These women follow a higher calling. Now remember, in the story with the the Hebrew midwives, it doesn't say they're necessarily Jewish. In fact, the exact translation is a midwife of the Hebrews. So these could have been Egyptians or Hebrews. But one thing we do know about the story is they knew God's law and they followed God's law. Now, I want you to think about how that applies to our situation today. How many times do we meet people who know God's law, who know all the Christian commandments, who know all the verses of the Bible, but their lives don't exactly match up with what they've learned? What they learned is not transformative, it's not revelatory. It doesn't call them to action, or it calls them to actions that are disjointed by what they're reading. You see, God calls us not only to be hearers of the word of God, but doers. Just like when Jesus was asking his disciples, who do people say that I am? You see, in that answer that Peter gave, Jesus was also expecting things of Peter and the disciples. Oh, you say I'm the Messiah? I'm going to give you the keys of the kingdom. I'm going to give you the power to forgive, to love, to do things just like you've seen me do. Are you up for it? Do you want to do it? Are you sure you want to call me the Messiah? You see, these women in this story in Exodus, they knew who their God was. And they knew no matter what Pharaoh was saying, they couldn't kill these kids. And that's how the Egyptian princess felt too. How could I get rid of this baby? I know who this baby is. I'm going to take this baby. I'm going to give this baby life, despite what the Pharaoh says. Are you willing to put yourself in the breach for someone in need? Are you willing to reach out to those in our society who have no voice, who are being marginalized by our laws? Are you willing to stand up for them? And to be that voice of reason, that voice of life, are you willing to do what the Bible calls us to do, to set the captives free, to raise the dead, to heal the sick, to visit the prisoners. Because if we're willing to do that, then we are following the footsteps of these heroic women in this chapter who knew what God's word was and then did what God's word commanded them to do. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. And now let us recite the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Now, Suffrage A, show us your mercy, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Clothe your ministers with righteousness. Let your people sing with joy. Give peace, O Lord, in all the world, for only in you can we live in safety. Lord, keep this nation under your care and guide us in the ways of justice and truth. Let your way be known upon the earth and your saving health among all the nations. Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten, nor the hope of the poor be taken away. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and sustain us with your Holy Spirit. Proper 16. Grant, we beseech thee, merciful God, that thy church, being gathered together in unity by the Holy Spirit, may manifest thy power among all people to the glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the same Spirit, one God, world without end. Amen. And now let us pray for the President of the United States and all in civil authority. O God, our Governor, whose glory is in all the world, we commend this nation to your merciful care, that being guided by your providence, we may dwell secure in your peace. Grant to the President of the United States, Donald, the Governor of this state, Ivy, and all in authority, wisdom and strength to know and to do your will. Fill them with the love of truth and righteousness, and make them ever mindful of their calling to serve this people in your fear, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end. Amen. Now, let us pray for our own needs and the needs of others. We continue to pray for Pat Clanton as she goes through her chemotherapy. We pray that God will comfort her during this very difficult time. For Ashley Sheik and her husband, as they go through quarantine, having caught the COVID virus. And I pray for both political parties in our country, that they will not resort to vitriol and hate, but remembering that our country was founded to try to be a more perfect union. Let us pray, Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayer, which we offer before you, for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. Thank you again for joining us. I pray that you will be generous during our time of offering. We just recently had our beans and rice ministry where we gave food packets over to over 55 families who were experiencing food distress. So please go visit our website and give generously. Let us now sing All Creatures of Our God and King. Again, thank you for your generosity. It is because of you and God's mercy that we can continue the work of serving God's people and serving our community to show the love and the mercy of our Savior. We are now entering a time of prayer for communion, even though we are not physically taking communion. we still want to, and if once when we say this prayer, it is our expression of our love of the body of Christ present in Holy Communion. In union, blessed Jesus, with the faithful gathered at every altar of your church, where your blessed body and blood are offered this day, and remembering particularly Christ Episcopal Church, Albertville, and those worshiping there, I long to offer you praise and thanksgiving for creation, all the blessings of this life, for the redemption won for us by your life, death, and resurrection, for the means of grace and hope of glory, and particularly for the blessings given me. I believe that you are truly present in Holy Sacrament, and since I cannot at this time receive communion, I pray you come into my heart, my soul, and my mind. Let nothing separate me from you. Let me serve you in this life until by your grace I come to your glorious kingdom and unending peace. Amen and amen. Now let us say the general thanksgiving. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ. For the means of grace and the hope of glory, we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercy that with truly thankful hearts we can show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but with our lives. By giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all of our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen. And now a prayer of St. Chrysostom's. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, Lord, our desires and petitions that may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Again, thank you for coming. Do not hesitate to visit us on Facebook, where we have evening prayer and weekly Bible studies, and where you can send your prayer requests, and we will pray for you, we promise. We are a loving church, and we long to reach each and every person in our city and even beyond. So thank you. Thank you for coming to worship with us today. Now let us sing our final hymn, and as we sing, I pray that God will touch your heart and that you will, after singing this hymn, want to know more about our Lord and Savior.